Lives of the Engineers, George and Robert Stephenson, by Samuel Smiles. Chapter 3. Engineman at Willington Quay and Killingworth. George Stephenson had now acquired the character of an expert workman. He was diligent and observant while at work, and sober and studious when the day's work was over. His friend Coe described him to the author as a standing example of manly character. On pay Saturday afternoons, when the pitmen held their fortnightly holiday, occupying themselves chiefly in cock-fighting and dog-fighting in the adjoining fields, followed by adjournments to the Yell House, George was accustomed to take his engine to pieces for the purpose of obtaining insight, and he cleaned all the parts and put the machine in thorough working order before leaving it. In the evenings he improved himself in the arts of reading and writing, and occasionally took a turn at modelling. It was at Callerton, his son Robert informed us, that he began to try his hand at original invention, and for some time he applied his attention to a machine in the nature of an engine brake, which reversed itself by its own action. But nothing came of the contrivance, and it was eventually thrown aside as useless. Yet not altogether so, for even the highest skill must undergo the inevitable discipline of experiment, and submit to the wholesome correction of occasional failure. After working at Callerton for about 2 years, he received an offer to take charge of the engine on Willington Ballast Hill at an advanced wage. He determined to accept it, and at the same time to marry Fanny Henderson and begin housekeeping on his own account. Though he was only 21 years old, he had contrived, by thrift, steadiness and industry, to save as much money as enabled him to take a cottage dwelling at Willington Quay and furnish it in a humble but comfortable style for the reception of his bride. Willington Quay lies on the north bank of the Tyne, about 6 miles below Newcastle. It consists of a line of houses straggling along the riverside, and high behind it towers up the huge mound of ballast emptied out of the ships which resort to the quay for their cargoes of coal for the London market. The ballast is thrown out of the ship's hold into wagons laid alongside, which are run up to the summit of the ballast hill, and emptied out there. At the foot of the great mound of shot rubbish was the fixed engine, of which George Stephenson acted as brakesman. The cottage in which he took up his abode was a small two-storied dwelling, standing a little back from the quay, with a bit of garden ground in front. The Stephenson family occupied the upper room in the west end of the cottage. Close behind rose the ballast hill. When the cottage dwelling had been made snug and was ready for occupation, the marriage took place. It was celebrated in Newburn Church on the 28th of November, 1802. After the ceremony, George, with his newly wedded wife, proceeded to the house of his father at Jolly's Close. The old man was now becoming infirm, and though he still worked as an engine fireman, contrived with difficulty to keep his head above water. When the visit had been paid, the bridal party set out for their new home at Willington Quay, whither they went in a manner quite common before travelling by railway came into use. Two farm horses, borrowed from a neighbouring farmer, were each provided with a saddle and pillion, and George, having mounted one, his wife seated herself behind him, holding on by his waist. The bridesman and bridesmaid in like manner mounted the other horse, and in this wise the wedding party rode across the country, passing through the old streets of Newcastle, and then by Wall's End to Willington Quay, a ride of about 15 miles. George Stephenson's daily life at Willington was that of a steady workman. By the manner, however, in which he continued to improve his spare hours in the evening, he was silently and surely paving the way for being something more than a manual labourer. He set himself to study diligently the principles of mechanics, and to master the laws by which his engine worked. For a workman, he was even at that time more than ordinarily speculative, often taking up strange theories, and trying to sift out the truth that was in them. While sitting by his wife's side in his cottage dwelling in the winter evenings, he was usually occupied in studying mechanical subjects or in modelling experimental machines. Among his various speculations while at Willington, he tried to discover a means of perpetual motion. Although he failed, as so many others had done before him, the very efforts he made tended to whet his inventive faculties, and to call forth his dormant powers. He went so far as to construct the model of a machine for the purpose. It consisted of a wooden wheel, the periphery of which was furnished with glass tubes filled with quicksilver. As the wheel rotated, the quicksilver poured itself down into the lower tubes, and thus a sort of self-acting motion was kept up in the apparatus, which, however, did not prove to be perpetual. Where he had first obtained the idea of this machine, whether from conversation or reading, is not known, but his son Robert was of opinion that he had heard of the apparatus of this kind described in the History of Inventions. As he had then no access to books, and indeed could barely read with ease, it is probable that he had been told of the contrivance, and set about testing its value according to his own methods. Much of his spare time continued to be occupied by labour more immediately profitable, regarded in the pecuniary point of view. In the evenings, after his day's labour at his engine, he would occasionally employ himself for an hour or two in casting ballast out of the collier ships, by which means he was enabled to earn a few extra shillings weekly. Mr. William Fairbairn of Manchester has informed us that, while Stephenson was employed at Willington, he himself was working in the neighbourhood as an engine apprentice at the Percy Main Colliery. He was very fond of George, who was a fine, hearty fellow, besides being a capital workman. In the summer evenings, young Fairbairn was accustomed to go down to the quay to see his friend, and on such occasions he would frequently take charge of George's engine while he took a turn at heaving ballast out of the ship's holds. It is pleasant to think of the future president of the British Association thus helping the future railway engineer to earn a few extra shillings by overwork in the evenings, at a time when both occupied the rank of humble working men in an obscure northern village. Mr. Fairbairn was also a frequent visitor at George's cottage on the quay, where, though there was no luxury, there was comfort, cleanliness, and a pervading spirit of industry. Even at home, George was never for a moment idle. When there was no ballast to heave out at the quay, he took in shoes to mend, and from mending he proceeded to making them, as well as shoe lasts, in which he was admitted to be very expert. But an accident occurred in Stephenson's household about this time, which had the effect of directing his industry into a new and still more profitable channel. The cottage chimney took fire one day in his absence, when the alarmed neighbours, rushing in, threw quantities of water on the flames, and some, in their zeal, even mounted the ridge of the house and poured buckets of water down the chimney. The fire was soon put out, but the house was thoroughly soaked. When George came home, he found everything in disorder, and his new furniture covered with soot. The 8-day clock, which hung against the wall, one of the most highly prized articles in the house, was much damaged by the steam with which the room had been filled, and its wheels were so clogged by the dust and soot that it was brought to a complete standstill. George was always ready to turn his hand to anything, and his ingenuity, never at fault, immediately set to work to repair the unfortunate clock. He was advised to send it to the clockmaker, but that would cost money, and he declared that he would repair it himself. At least he would try. The clock was accordingly taken to pieces and cleaned. The tools which he had been accumulating for the purpose of constructing his perpetual motion machine enabled him to do this readily, and he succeeded so well that, shortly after, the neighbours sent him their clocks to clean, and he soon became one of the most famous clock doctors in the neighbourhood. It was while living at Willington Quay that George Stephenson's only son was born, on the 16th of October, 1803. The child was a great favourite with his father, and added much to the happiness of his evening hours. George's philoprogenitiveness, as phrenologists call it, had been exercised hitherto upon birds, dogs, rabbits, and even the poor old gin horses, which he had driven at the Callerton Pit, but in his boy he now found a much more genial object for the exercise of his affection. The christening took place in the schoolhouse at Wall's End, the old parish church being at the time in so dilapidated a condition, from the creeping or subsidence of the ground, consequent upon the excavation of the coal, that it was considered dangerous to enter it. On this occasion, Robert Gray and Anne Henderson, who had officiated as bridesman and bridesmaid at the wedding, came over again to Willington and stood godfather and godmother to little Robert, so named after his grandfather. After working for several years more as a brakesman at the Willington machine, George Stephenson was induced to leave his situation there for a similar one at the West Moor Colliery, Killingworth. It was not without considerable persuasion that he was induced to leave the quay, as he knew that he should thereby give up the chance of earning extra money by casting ballast from the keels. At last, however, he consented, in the hope of making up the loss in some other way. The village of Killingworth lies about 7 miles north of Newcastle, and is one of the best-known collieries in that neighbourhood. The workings of the coal are of vast extent, and give employment to a large number of workpeople. To this place Stephenson first came as brakesman about the beginning of 1805. He had not been long in his new place ere his wife died in 1806, shortly after giving birth to a daughter, who survived the mother only a few months. George deeply felt the loss of his wife, for they had been very happy together. Their lot had been sweetened by a daily successful toil. The husband was sober and hard-working, and his wife made his hearth so bright and his home so snug that no attraction could draw him from her side in the evening hours. But this domestic happiness was all to pass away, and George felt as one that had thenceforth to tread the journey of life alone. Shortly after this event, while his grief was still fresh, he received an invitation from some gentleman concerned in a large spinning works near Montrose in Scotland to proceed thither and superintend the working of one of Bolton and Watt's engines. He accepted the offer, and made arrangements to leave Killingworth for a time. Having left his little boy in good keeping, he set out upon his long journey to Scotland on foot, with his kit upon his back. While working at Montrose, he gave a striking proof of that practical ability in contrivance for which he was afterwards so distinguished. It appears that the water required for the purposes of his engine, as well as for the use of the works, was pumped from a considerable depth, being supplied from the adjacent extensive sand strata. The pumps frequently got choked by the sand drawn in at the bottom of the well through the snore holes, or apertures through which the water to be raised is admitted. The barrels soon became worn, and the bucket and clack leathers destroyed, so that it became necessary to devise a remedy. And with this object, the engineman proceeded to adopt the following simple but original expedient. He had a wooden box or boot made, 12 feet high, which he placed in the sump or well, and into this he inserted the lower end of the pump. The result was that the water flowed clear from the outer part of the well over into the boot, and being drawn up without any admixture of sand, the difficulty was thus conquered. Being paid good wages, Stephenson contrived, during the year he worked at Montrose, to save a sum of £28, which he took back with him to Killingworth. Longing to get back to his kindred, his heart yearning for the son whom he had left behind, our engineman took leave of his employers, and trudged back to Northumberland on foot as he had gone. While on his journey southward, he arrived late one evening, footsore and wearied, at the door of a small farmer's cottage, at which he knocked, and requested shelter for the night. It was refused, and then he entreated that, being tired and unable to proceed further, the farmer would permit him to lie down in the outhouse. For that a little clean straw would serve him. The farmer's wife appeared at the door, looked at the traveller, then, retiring with her husband, the two confabulated a little apart, and finally they invited Stephenson into the cottage. Always full of conversation and anecdote, he soon made himself at home in the farmer's family, and spent with them a few pleasant hours. He was hospitably entertained for the night, and when he left the cottage in the morning, he pressed them to make some charge for his lodging, but they refused to accept any recompense. They only asked him to remember them kindly, and if he ever came that way, to be sure and call again. Many years after, when Stephenson had become a thriving man, he did not forget the humble pair who had succoured and entertained him on his way. He sought their cottage again, when age had silvered their hair, and when he left the aged couple, they may have been reminded of the old saying that we may sometimes entertain angels unawares. Reaching home, Stephenson found that his father had met with a serious accident at the Blucher pit, which had reduced him to great distress and poverty. While engaged in the inside of an engine making some repairs, a fellow workman accidentally let in the steam upon him. The blast struck him full in the face. He was terribly scorched, and his eyesight was irretrievably lost. The helpless and infirm man had struggled for a time with poverty. His sons, who were at home poor as himself, were little able to help him, while George was at a distance in Scotland. On his return, however, with his savings in his pocket, his first step was to pay off his father's debts, amounting to about £15, and shortly after he removed the aged pair from Jolly's Close to a comfortable cottage adjoining the tram road near the West Moor at Killingworth, where the old man lived for many years, supported entirely by his son. Stephenson was again taken on as a brakesman at the West Moor pit. He does not seem to have been very hopeful as to his prospects in life about this time, 1807-8. Indeed, the condition of the working class generally was very discouraging. England was engaged in a great war, which pressed upon the industry and severely tried the resources of the country. There was a constant demand for men to fill the army. The working people were also liable to be pressed for the navy or drawn for the militia, and though they could not fail to be discontented under such circumstances, they scarcely dared even to mutter their discontent to their neighbours. Stephenson was drawn for the militia. He must therefore either quit his work and go a-soldiering, or find a substitute. He adopted the latter course, and borrowed £6, which, with the remainder of his savings, enabled him to provide a militiaman to serve in his stead. Thus the whole of his hard-won earnings were swept away at a stroke. He was almost in despair, and contemplated the idea of leaving the country and emigrating to the United States. Although a voyage thither was then a much more formidable thing for a working man to accomplish than a voyage to Australia is now, he seriously entertained the project, and had all but made up his mind to go. His sister Anne, with her husband, emigrated about that time, but George could not raise the requisite money, and they departed without him. After all, it went sore against his heart to leave his home and his kindred, the scenes of his youth and the friends of his boyhood, and he struggled long with the idea, brooding over it in sorrow. Speaking afterwards to a friend of his thoughts at the time, he said, "You know, the road from my house at the West Moor to Killingworth, I remember once when I went along that road I wept bitterly, for I knew not where my lot in life would be cast." In 1808, Stephenson, with two other brakesmen, took a small contract under the colliery lessees for breaking the engines at the West Moor pit. The brakesmen found the oil and tallow, they divided the work amongst them, and were paid so much per score for their labour. It was the interest of the brakesmen to economise the working as much as possible, and George no sooner entered upon the contract than he proceeded to devise ways and means of making it pay. He observed that the ropes, which at other pits in the neighbourhood lasted about 3 months, at the West Moor pit became worn out in about a month. He immediately set about ascertaining the cause of the defect, and finding it to be occasioned by excessive friction, he proceeded, with the sanction of the head engine wright and the colliery owners, to shift the pulley wheels and rearrange the gearing, which had the effect of greatly diminishing the tear and wear, besides allowing the work of the colliery to proceed without interruption. About the same time he attempted an improvement in the winding engine, which he worked by placing a valve between the air pump and the condenser. This expedient, although it led to no practical result, showed that his mind was actively engaged in studying new mechanical adaptations. It continued to be his regular habit on Saturdays to take his engine to pieces for the purpose, at the same time, of familiarising himself with its action, and of placing it in a state of thorough working order. By mastering its details he was enabled, as opportunity occurred, to turn to practical account the knowledge he thus diligently and patiently acquired. Such an opportunity was not long in presenting itself. In the year 1810 a new pit was sunk by the Grand Allies, the lessees of the mines, at the village of Killingworth, now known as the Killingworth High Pit. an atmospheric or Newcomen engine made by Smeaton was fixed there for the purpose of pumping out the water from the shaft, but somehow it failed to clear the pit. As one of the workmen has since described the circumstance, "She couldn't keep her jackhead in water. All the enginemen in the neighbourhood were tried, as well as Crowther of the Ousburn, but they were clean bet." The engine had been fruitlessly pumping for nearly 12 months, and began to be spoken of as a total failure. Stephenson had gone to look at it when in the course of erection, and then observed to the overman that he thought it was defective. He also gave it as his opinion that if there were much water in the mine, the engine would never keep it under. Of course, as he was only a brakesman, his opinion was considered to be worth very little on such a point. He continued, however, to make frequent visits to the engine to see how she was getting on. From the bank head where he worked his brake, he could see the chimney smoking at the high pit, and as the men were passing to and from their work, he would call out and inquire if they'd gotten to the bottom yet, and the reply was always to the same effect. The pumping made no progress, and the workmen were still drowned out. On Saturday afternoon, he went over to the high pit to examine the engine more carefully than he had yet done. He had been turning the subject over thoughtfully in his mind, and seemed to have satisfied himself as to the cause of the failure. Kit Heppel, one of the sinkers, asked him, "Well, George, what's your muck of her? Do you think you could do anything to improve her?" Said George, "I could alter her mun and make a draw. In a week's time I could send you to the bottom." Forthwith Heppel reported this conversation to Ralph Dodds, the head viewer, who, being now quite in despair and hopeless of succeeding with the engine, determined to give George's skill a trial. At the worst he could only fail, as the rest had done. In the evening Dodds went in search of Stephenson, and met him on the road, dressed in his Sunday suit, on the way to the preaching in the Methodist chapel, which he attended. "Well, George," said Dodds, "they tell me you think you can put the engine at the high pit to rights." "Yes, sir," said George, "I think I could." "If that's the case, I'll give you a fair trial, and you must set to work immediately. We're clean drowned out and cannot get a stop further. The engineers hereabout are all bit, and if you can really succeed in accomplishing what they cannot do, you may depend on it I'll make you a man for life." Stephenson began his operations early the next morning. The only condition he made before setting to work was that he should select his own workmen. There was, as he knew, a great deal of jealousy among the regular men that a colliery brakesman should pretend to know more about their engine than they themselves did, and attempt to remedy defects which the most skilled men of their craft, including the engineer of the colliery, had failed to do. But George made the condition a sine qua non. "The workmen," said he, "must either be all Whigs or all Tories." There was no help for it, so Dodds ordered the old hands to stand aside. The men grumbled, but gave way, and then George and his party went in. The engine was taken entirely to pieces. The cistern containing the injection water was raised 10 feet. The injection cock, being too small, was enlarged to nearly double its former size, and it was so arranged that it should be shut off quickly at the beginning of the stroke. These and other alterations were necessarily performed in a rough way, but as the result proved on true principles. Stephenson also, finding that the boiler would bear a greater pressure than 5 pounds to the inch, determined to work it at a pressure of 10 pounds, though this was contrary to the directions of both Newcomen and Smeaton. The necessary alterations were made in about 3 days, and many persons came to see the engine start, including all the men who had put her up. The pit being nearly full of water, she had little to do on starting, and, to use George's words, came bounce into the house. Dodds exclaimed, "Why, she was better as she was now. She'll knock the house down." After a short time, however, the engine got fairly to work, and by 10 o'clock that night the water was lower in the pit than it had ever been before. It was kept pumping all Thursday, and by the Friday afternoon the pit was cleared of water, and the workmen were sent to the bottom, as Stephenson had promised. Thus the alterations effected in the pumping apparatus proved completely successful. Dodds was particularly gratified with the manner in which the job had been done, and he made Stephenson a present of £10, which, though very inadequate when compared with the value of the work performed, was accepted with gratitude. George was proud of the gift as the first marked recognition of his skill as a workman, and he used afterwards to say that it was the biggest sum of money he had up to that time earned in one lump. Ralph Dodds, however, did more than this. He released the brakesman from the handles of his engine at West Moor, and appointed him engineman at the High Pit at good wages during the time the pit was sinking, the job lasting for about a year, and he also kept him in mind for further advancement. Stephenson's skill as an engine doctor soon became noised abroad, and he was called upon to prescribe remedies for all the old, wheezy and ineffective pumping machines in the neighbourhood. In this capacity he soon left the regular men far behind, though they in their turn were very much disposed to treat the Killingsworth brakesman as no better than a quack. Nevertheless, his practice was really founded upon a close study of the principles of mechanics, and on an intimate, practical acquaintance with the details of the pumping engine. Another of his smaller achievements in the same line is still told by the people of the district. At the corner of the road leading to Long Benton there was a quarry from which a peculiar and scarce kind of ochre was taken. In the course of working it out, the water had collected in considerable quantities, and there being no means of draining it off, it accumulated to such an extent that the further working of the ochre was almost entirely stopped. Ordinary pumps were tried and failed, and then a windmill was tried and failed too. On this, George was asked what ought to be done to clear the quarry of the water. He said he would set up for them an engine a little bigger than a kale-pot that would clear them out in a week. And he did so. A little engine was speedily erected, by means of which the quarry was pumped dry in the course of a few days. Thus his skill as a pump doctor soon became the marvel of the district. In elastic, muscular vigour, Stephenson was now in his prime, and he still continued to be zealous in measuring his strength and agility with his fellow workmen. The competitive element in his nature was always strong, and his success in these feats of rivalry was certainly remarkable. Few, if any, could lift such weights, throw the hammer or put the stone so far, or cover so great a space at a standing or running leap. One day, between the engine hour and the rope-rolling hour, Kit Heppel challenged him to leap from one high wall to another with a deep gap between. To Heppel's surprise and dismay, George took the standing leap and cleared the 11 feet at a bound. Had his eye been less accurate, or his limbs less agile and sure, the feat must have cost him his life. But so full of redundant muscular vigour was he, that leaping, putting, or throwing the hammer were not enough for him. He was also ambitious of riding on horseback, and as he had not yet been promoted to an office enabling him to keep a horse of his own, he sometimes borrowed one of the gin horses for a ride. On one of these occasions he brought the animal back reeking, when Tommy Mitcheson, the bank horsekeeper, a rough-spoken fellow, exclaimed to him, "Set such fellows as you on horseback, and you'll soon ride to the devil!" But Tommy Mitcheson lived to tell the joke, and to confess that, after all, there had been a better issue to George's horsemanship than that which he predicted. Old Cree, the engine wright at Killingworth High Pit, having been killed by an accident, George Stephenson was, in 1812, appointed engine wright of the colliery at a salary of £100 a year. He was also allowed the use of a galloway to ride upon in his visits of inspection to the collieries leased by the Grand Allies in that neighbourhood. The Grand Allies were a company of gentlemen, consisting of Sir Thomas Liddell, afterwards Lord Ravensworth, the Earl of Strathmore, and Mr. Stuart Wortley, afterwards Lord Warncliffe, the lessees of the Killingworth collieries. Having been informed of the merits of Stephenson, of his indefatigable industry, and the skill which he had displayed in the repairs of the pumping engines, they readily acceded to Mr. Dodd's recommendation that he should be appointed the colliery engine wright, and as we shall afterwards find, they continued to honour him by distinguished marks of their approval. End of chapter 3.